Hi, I'm Doug, and I want to encourage you in studying the biblical languages, Hebrew, Greek, and Aramaic. Dr. Scott Callaham is here to help me talk about the forgotten biblical language. Dr. Scott Callaham is a PhD graduate of Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary, dissertation on modality and the biblical Hebrew infinitive absolute. He has served in a missionary context as a theological educator in Asia, Chinese, and he is the dean of the Institute of Public Theology, and I have met him through his role as the host of Daily Dose of Aramaic, which some of you may watch. Scott, it's great to have you on the program today.
Thanks so much. I've been looking forward to this, to be able to engage with you and your audience.
Well, let's talk about this forgotten biblical language, Aramaic. I mean, should it just be forgotten? It's not really, there's not really that much of it. Is it really that important?
Well, when you allude to there not being much of it, what we're talking about is most of the Aramaic in the Bible is in parts of Daniel and parts of Ezra. So if we didn't have that, there'd only be the one verse in Jeremiah and two words in Genesis. And then, of course, there is the background of Aramaic in the New Testament, where there are some Aramaic words that appear in the New Testament also. But all of that having been taken into account, there's not that much Aramaic in the Bible. So the question is, should it be forgotten? Should we really remember and take advantage of the fact that we have a whole field of study, Aramaic studies, and then apply that to our knowledge of the Bible? And the thing is, our attitude toward the Bible, of course, should be that every single word is what the Bible says it is. It's the, you know, the precious word of God. The word of God is authoritative, and it's sufficient. So it's not just sufficient in 99% of the Old Testament, the Hebrew parts, but the extra 1% that constitutes the Aramaic parts. And in fact, if you think about the book of Daniel, the parts that are in Aramaic, they're sort of the most famous parts, actually, and the parts that tend to show up, not just in Bible stories, but actually as background for New Testament theology. So Aramaic is very important from a whole Bible theology standpoint, as well as, you know, situating ourselves in New Testament theology. And that's before even getting into further studies about how Aramaic was one of the world languages. So we're kind of familiar with the idea that the Greek of the New Testament was a world language. It was the international language,
yes,
of
the lingua franca.
Roman Empire. That's right. That's right. So the way that people from, say, Rome and modern-day Turkey would communicate with us, with each other, would be to use Greek in Roman times. Well, Aramaic actually had that standing previously. So that's why the Jews were speaking Aramaic in Jesus' time, is because they had gotten entrained in the interaction of cultures when they were taken to exile in Babylon and so forth. And thus, they spoke the international language of the day. So beyond the Bible, going to biblical backgrounds, Aramaic is an extremely important language. And that's before getting into the documents in Aramaic among the Dead Sea Scrolls and other really important documents for our overall understanding of the Bible world. So, you know, very important language. And
yes,
so should we study Aramaic is another thing you brought up. Is it too much trouble, basically, to study a language that's only 1% of the Old Testament? And, you know, there's hope for the person who's in despair at the idea of studying yet another biblical language, because I think we all recognize that the biblical languages are probably the most challenging subjects in a theological education curriculum for most people. It's totally understandable. Yes. It's a totally different nature of study required, in that you need to really rehearse what you've learned every day for maximum effectiveness. And then it's intended for daily use in not only in undergirding every other subject in the theological curriculum, but also use in reading and interpreting the Bible. So we grant that the study of the biblical languages is challenging. So how in the world can you fit in a third biblical language is the issue. And the thing is, Aramaic, hopefully to the relief of many people who have felt this way, is actually very similar to Hebrew. Probably more similar to Hebrew than, say, Italian and Spanish are similar to each other. So similar, and they're different languages. This is the language of the Arameans that's then brought into the service of being an international language. It becomes a Jewish language and so forth. So not originally a Jewish language, not a Canaanite language, anything like that. But it's part of a continuum of languages, of Semitic languages in the ancient world. So if you've studied Hebrew, you don't have to sort of start over like you have to do with Greek, you know?
Right. One
of the things that students tend to like about Greek study is it feels familiar somehow. And the reason is we're speaking right now English, a language that's in the same overall language family as Greek. The Indo-European language family is what I'm talking about. And that's not the case for Hebrew. The words that sort of we intuitively know from Hebrew are Bible words like hallelujah and so forth, amen. But Aramaic, it's so similar to Hebrew, it's a shame not to get Aramaic if you've already put in the effort to study Hebrew. And that is really the intuition and the drive that was partly behind me writing the book that I see in the background there.
Ah, yes. Yes, your baby.
Yes. How do you like that transition?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, when you start this study and you start studying Aramaic, do you have to learn the alphabet again? Do you have to, start from scratch? No, and this tells you why.
Yes, well, what you're alluding to there is my frustration in the sort of the teaching grammars and reference grammars that existed before the writing of BABY, Biblical Aramaic for Biblical Interpreters, which was there would be the concession that there was the expectation that students would have learned Hebrew before, but not really much benefit drawn from that in the study of the language as it unfolded in a teaching grammar. Meaning, really, the learning burden was put on the student to draw upon Hebrew learning for the benefit of the Aramaic. And this just stems from my time studying Aramaic myself in my seminary program, where all we had at that time were what are sort of more intermediate or reference grammars today. And the student totally had to put everything together, and everything was sort of written out in dense paragraphs, very little in terms of graphical assistance for the learning process. So I just, in frustration, way back in the MDiv era, said to myself, why are we making this so hard, learning Aramaic? This is 10 times harder than it needs to be. Why has no one simply placed the Hebrew we know at this point in our studies on the left side of an open book and placed the Aramaic we're learning right across from it on the right side so that we can compare and contrast and not sort of be in constant state of confusion over this looks familiar, but I'm not so sure because I barely hung on in my Hebrew studies. Is my intuition right or wrong here? No confusion. It's right there on the page. And of course, the reason why no one had done it yet is that that's what my burden would be for many years later to write the Biblical Aramaic for Biblical Interpreters. So, you know, I believe the unique contribution of the book is very much in the teaching aspect of it. Here in this grammar, we have a book that doesn't assume that you've got it all together already.
Right.
You know, and it's not per se a handholding. It's just being friendly with the student and saying, I know where you are.
Yes.
And look, the great thing is where you are is a good place. You're ready for this. You know, it's like I was saying before, why would you not just expend a small amount of additional effort and get the benefit of the third biblical language?
Yes. Well, I really appreciate your work and what that reflects in your teacher's heart here, because obviously students have to take some initiative and expend some effort, but we don't want to put extra obstacles in their way. And when we can scaffold learning to this degree to help them just take that next step, it just we're removing that and giving them this wonderful invitation and helping them learn what they don't know by what they already do know. And I love what you're doing with this.
Well, thank you.
I was looking in your introduction earlier about some of the reasons there, the time aspect being one of them, and like we've talked, just the fact that we don't have what is it? It's 269 verses in the Old Testament that we're talking about that are Aramaic or have a portion of Aramaic in them. What would you say to folks that are thinking about this from, you know, we've talked on this channel many times from a student perspective and at times from a teacher perspective, but what if you were talking, say, to a school that's looking at structuring a program around these languages, and they say, we just can't do, you know, three. It's all we can do to get two. What would you recommend in those kind of scenarios?
Right. Well, my book and its teaching method are actually designed to help in exactly this circumstance. Because of the fact that there's this great similarity between the Hebrew you know and the Aramaic that you're learning, my method, of course, one could draw it out over an entire semester. And the book is constructed that way with special learning exercises that the class can talk through and really get a lot of extra reinforcement through inductive learning done. But if all you have is a week, meaning an intensive class over a week, this is also an ideal method because of that sort of running head start that students have due to their Hebrew learning. So, you know, it is a concern, the amount of time that one must invest to learn a language. And we don't want to dismiss practical considerations, like how are you going to fit in yet another class in a robust, biblical language full Master Divinity, say, or other program of study. How are you going to do that? Well, this is easy. Do it in a week, for instance, that kind of thing. And so to illustrate how I believe this is just fitting and natural and good and shouldn't actually stress out any administrator trying to figure out where the course credit should go, is I'm the dean of the Institute of Public Theology. And as far as I know, at present, we have the only programs like Master of Divinity, where it's standard to study all three languages. And the way that I teach with Biblical Aramaic for Biblical Interpreters is providing a full review of the Hebrew you've learned in, say, a grammar year. So actually, a great time to pick up the book from my publisher, Glossa House, or on Amazon or whatever, would be as you're finishing up your first year of Hebrew to give you that everything's laid out in a review category, again, on the left side of the page, the Hebrew review.
Right.
Well, then, look, just scoot on over and get Aramaic right after that. And so that's what we're doing here at the Institute of Public Theology. I'm teaching Hebrew right now and looking forward very soon to doing a comprehensive review with my students and giving them Aramaic along the way. And then when in their ministries, they're perhaps preaching through the book of Daniel or Ezra or something like that, they don't have to sort of step back from the serious engagement with the text that they would be doing with their Hebrew and just depend on a commentary or something. They don't have to do that when they get to the Aramaic parts. In fact, they can deepen their appreciation of those biblical books in those areas because it doesn't seem that many people have studied Aramaic, so that exegetical benefit is just going to seem all the more precious then.
Yes, absolutely. And one thing I noticed on the Daily Dose of Aramaic website, you've got entire lessons already pre-recorded there as well. So students could be getting a head start or even learn independently that way too, right?
Right. And so if there are viewers who are not familiar with the Daily Dose channels, so there's Daily Dose of Hebrew, which was actually the first one. Then Daily Dose of Greek came along, and then Latin, and then now Aramaic. So we have the three biblical languages plus the ability to learn Hebrew, Latin for reading the Vulgate, which is an important Bible translation in Christian history. Well, on each of the biblical language channels, there's a Learn tab.
Yes.
So the Read tab is kind of what Daily Dose is famous for, where we're taking 1 to 3 minutes every day and reading a biblical passage, or if maybe for a long verse, maybe just a part of it, and then doing a grammatical analysis and then helping everybody understand how we get an understanding of that part of Scripture. Well, on the Learn tab, each of us who have authored a textbook then are teaching through the textbook. So that's one place that a person could go where I become your Aramaic teacher, and we walk through the language, the language study of Biblical Aramaic for Biblical interpreters.
That's great. That's I walked away a few years from Hebrew, and the Daily Dose sites helped me get back to the biblical languages, and those learn tabs were just critical for getting me ready to jump back into seminary. So I highly recommend you guys that are listening to take advantage of these awesome resources. And maybe we'll see this, offered more in terms of this would be a great winter intensive or a great summer intensive, like you say, the week-long course. And I'd like to take one myself sometime just to get in there and see other people, encourage them in this. Yeah, the Daily Dose ministries, though, very helpful to me as an English-speaking seminary student in the United States. But those ministries are not simply for people like me, right?
Yeah, so that's a good point. We, with the Daily Dose Ministries, are trying to serve basically the church and other individuals worldwide with what we're doing. And, you know, this is free. I mean, people are certainly also free to click on the donate tab to help us in what we're doing.
Okay.
Because there's a technological side to what we're doing in Daily Dose of Aramaic. I don't get paid for this, but we do want to pay the people who, you know, run the website for us and stuff like that. So we welcome that. But something I'm really excited about, for instance, with the Daily Dose Ministries, is that we're launching other meta language channels. So what I mean is, at present, we have Daily Dose of Greek, also, if I can remember right, Korean, Spanish, and Chinese so far.
Wow. Yeah.
And I've talked with a PhD graduate of Southern Seminary who's sort of being courted to do the Portuguese version of Daily Dose of Greek. Daily Dose of Hebrew, I'm so excited. I think there might be another language channel I'm missing there, but Daily Dose of Hebrew and Chinese is coming. And so, you know, what a wonderful thing. But as far as Aramaic goes, okay, in my life, I only have the time to do this in English. But for those who are native Chinese speakers, I would want people to know that Biblical Aramaic for Biblical Interpreters is also available in Chinese, Sheng Jing Ya Lan Wan. And it's by a publisher in Taiwan, and it's currently available on Logos Bible Software also. So if you're not able to get the book from that publisher or a U.S. distributor, it's available in Chinese. So as a native Chinese speaker, that might be valuable for approaching it through your own language instead of filtering through English as an instruction language. We tend to associate biblical language study with people who are preparing for full-time ministry in a seminary setting. But really, I believe that the biblical languages are something, are a study that any serious, a person who's serious about the Bible should consider. And what I mean is, I think there's a regrettable tendency to get into something that is called linguistic gnosticism, which is sort of being fascinated by the fact that the Bible was not originally in English. So it's a good recognition that the Bible was not originally written in English, but the fascination kind of resulting in a gullibility of fantastical claims being made about the biblical languages and on a kind of Bible code level, if you know what I mean.
Sure.
And there's really bad linguistics, meaning it's not really linguistics, it's also more like pseudo-linguistics, done, for example, with taking Hebrew words back to Paleo-Hebrew, back to the sort of picture signs that helped formed the Hebrew letters, and then deriving a different meaning for the Hebrew word out of the pictograms
based on the shape of a letter.
There is absolutely no linguistic basis for that.
Yeah.
It is amazing that people get into that kind of study and just kind of run in circles about finding all kinds of hidden meaning in very common words that it's kind of hard to, you know, kind of break the bad news sometimes, that it's like, guys, you should be studying the language. You know, how long should you be dwelling on the alphabet? Well, about a day. I mean, you need to get into reading this actual text as a straightforward transmitter of truth, not try to dig underneath. There's nothing there, you know, in this way of thinking. So anyway, that's just to bring up, we don't want to go linguistic Gnosticism, that approach in our biblical studies, but we want to encourage people to think of the biblical languages as these are conductors of truth, where we're not missing out on the key doctrines of the faith or anything due to having to depend on Bible translations for most people. But there's an element of richness that only comes from reading the Bible in the form in which it was given. You know, and so that's why we advocate for biblical languages for everybody. And then back to the people who are preparing for ministry, there's sort of a confidence that comes from standing on the solid ground of the text rather than on your favorite commentator.
Yes.
Because not only your favorite commentator, but of course you can be wrong. But when you're standing on the text itself, then you're not depending on personal opinion. You're as much as possible peeling away layers of personal opinions of yourself and others when you're dealing with the grammar and syntax of a text.
Yes, and just trying to get there down to the text, down to the source as much as possible.
Right. And it's interesting, in some theological circles, there's a suspicion of this kind of biblicism that I haven't quite figured it out, because the very same folks will claim that they believe in biblical authority and sufficiency. But there's not, kind of, when you cast doubt on the value of doing what we're talking about right here, of submitting yourself to the text rather than placing yourself above the text. So I'm really heartened to be in a ministry that has that in mind with these other Daily Dose channels in other languages. So as they debut, I would hope that our Daily Dose viewers and others would make sure that speakers of those languages would be able to find out about this free resource available worldwide. So there's that concern. And actually, this brings up kind of something that should be a priority for the world church, much more so than it is. And so if I may, just I'd like to bring up my missions textbook, World Mission, Theology, Strategy, and Current Issues, which is also available on Logos Bible software, including a Chinese version that just came out this last year. So what does this have to do with biblical languages? Well, an overlooked part of world mission efforts in obedience to the Great Commission has to do with the theological approach to language. And what I mean is, when we're talking about Great Commission obedience, obviously, we want to found that obedience on what is actually there in the text, right? So there's that aspect of using language, in this case, Greek, you know, biblical Greek, to see what the Great Commission says. But let's step back and think about how we're sending people to cultures around the world, and not just English speakers, of course, but Great Commission obedience from everywhere to everywhere is what the Bible teaches. You know, disciples make disciples. But as we're doing this, we should be thinking theologically about the dynamic of language learning. And what often gets left out at the very beginning of this consideration of missionary language learning is the biblical languages. Because if we picture, say, the missionary right here, and the people that they're witnessing to over here, we obviously realize, if I put my fingers at the right place, we obviously realize that there's a language gap right here that needs to be crossed by the missionary to that culture, that host culture. That's necessary because you got to bridge the gap, right? Well, if the missionary doesn't know the biblical languages, there's a gap there, a wide gap between that missionary and the biblical text that is the missionary's message. So to eliminate these gaps as much as possible, it makes just as much sense for missionaries to be competent in biblical languages as they should be competent in the language of their host people. Why? Well, of course, their ability to carry the message of the Bible accurately, but also at no point to imply that to get the true word from God, you need to get it through English, right?
Yes.
So there should come a time. It's not the first time that a people is exposed to the message of the Bible, but there should come a time when we treat these people as true brothers and sisters of the world church, right? And treat them with the respect that these people need to be able to handle the word of truth just like everyone else. There could be folks among this people group who God has already decided these people need to have better grasp of Bible and theology than the messenger who brought it in the first place. Mm. These people need folks who are going to read Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek for themselves, not going through an English educational system as right now, at least, is necessary for doing a PhD. Yeah, not doing that, not going through English, but going directly to the biblical languages to be able to be confident handlers of the word of truth in their context. That's important too. And that should be a priority effort of cultures like ours that engage in missionary work for the benefit of others, is to be able to not hold back the treasure of biblical language knowledge for ourselves, as if we have this attitude that the sophisticated people deserve that, the unsophisticated people don't. Forget that nonsense. Forget that paternalism.
That's right.
Forget that dumbing down impulse that unfortunately is very common in Western, at least, missionary efforts. It's demeaning. And it doesn't treat people as brothers and sisters in the faith, brothers and sisters in Christ, to hold back biblical truth. So that's kind of what I go into in the language chapter of World Mission. But there's a lot more there, like having a theological approach to the missionaries' learning of the host nation language as well. Our topic being biblical languages, I just wanted to emphasize that because
yes.
It is a rare missionary who can read the Bible in the original languages. And just the problem with that is the implication that it's not important.
Right. Well, may we see that turn around, and thankful that we've got more people seeing that and more resources to help in that regard.
So, you know, about the knowledge of biblical languages among missionaries, we can take examples from history like Adoniram Judson. What Bible was he reading on the ship coming from the U.S. over to India, firstly, to meet William Carey, and then onward to his final destination? He was reading the Greek New Testament. What New Testament did John Wesley read? The Greek New Testament. What Bible did Luther translate? Well, the Hebrew and Aramaic Old Testament and the Greek New Testament. And so some people might say, well, yeah, I understand Luther and, you know, founders of big movements like Wesley. But what about Adoniram Judson, right? Well, you might say, well, he was especially gifted. Well, William Carey, the guy he was coming to meet, others. It used to be presumed that missionaries would be so intimate with the Word of God that in the very likely case that they would need to be the first Bible translators for a newly discovered people group with their language, that, well, the man on the scene, he's going to do it. Right there. And the thing I think a lot of people don't realize is there are many languages that don't have scripture yet. We need that kind of person, not only the super skilled linguist, but the standard missionary. Who's going to be the one who's going to contact these people? Someone who's only going to go so far with their language knowledge that it's only for speaking. We need to have scripture in these other languages. So we need people who, of course, know the language intimately that they're speaking with people in, but also the biblical languages, to be able to reduce that gap as far as possible between the word and the people.
Right. Well, I appreciate your heart and your perspective on these things, Scott. And going back to the book here with your approach with learning the Aramaic through means of the Hebrew as a reference and as a starting point there, are there any particular areas that you would alert folks to? While it's certainly encouraging that we've got a Semitic language family, we've got the same alphabet, so they don't even have to learn the alphabet, and you've got a lot of parts of speech and constructions that are similar. Are there any particular differences that you say, hey, here are some things you really will benefit from getting once you're in here?
Okay. Well, there are some differences that, of course, jump right out due to the presentation method of the book, where there's actually a whole chapter where it's Hebrew only, because it's a dynamic that doesn't exist in Aramaic. So that's the where there's a vav in the front, and it's that kind of verb. So what I call the type 2 vekatal, for instance, you know, that doesn't exist in Aramaic, and the vayiktol doesn't exist in Aramaic. So before we started recording, we were talking about, then if there is no vayiktol, is there any narrative past in Aramaic? What it looks like, and the reader of the book sees this, so we sort of already have a past tense, the so-called perfect. But that having been said, it's, you know, right there, we see so much of it in Daniel. There's edayin and bedayin, these particles that will show up at the front, kind of like a vayiktol does, of a sentence to kind of say, and then this happened, and then this happened, and then this happened, where there have been studies like by Randall Booth and Brian, I think it's pronounced Toews, T-O-E-W-S.
Right. Dissertation.
About these sequential movements here in Biblical Aramaic. So that's a difference just to be aware of. There's no infinitive absolute in Biblical Aramaic, because it looks like that sort of the infinitive absolute as a native Semitic language feature had dropped out of Aramaic by that time.
Oh, so that's why you couldn't do your dissertation on the infinitive absolute in Biblical Aramaic.
Right. You know, I'm trying to deal with every infinitive absolute in the Bible. I'm like, hey, why aren't there any right here?
Right.
But it's interesting. I mean, this is more semantic, right, than language, but language features from the structure. But this is kind of interesting to me that one of the resources I cite in the book is a dissertation that pointed out that God's name never appears in Biblical Aramaic. Because, you know, many, many reasons a person could come up with. This is the language of the Gentiles at the time. We're in pagan courts. It's correspondence with, you know, empire officials and so forth. Well, yes. But it's interesting, right as the Biblical Aramaic in Ezra ends, God's name appears in Hebrew right afterwards. And it seems like God's name has been reserved from appearing in Biblical Aramaic. So I think that's an interesting dynamic, that it seems like there was a linguistic self-awareness, if you will, in the composition of right. Daniel and Ezra. And if that's true, that should actually help us with our interpretation of Jeremiah 10:11. So, you know, you're preaching, you're teaching Jeremiah chapter 10, and then bam, right in the middle, interestingly, sort of chiastically middle of the chapter, here you have this one sentence in Aramaic. What's going on, right? So it seems like the pattern in the Bible is a linguistic self-awareness. It seems intentional from that standpoint, as well as, you know, literarily and so forth. So they're just structural things that are interesting to note between Biblical Hebrew and Aramaic that are different. One thing also that I had not seen in other textbooks is the idea of showing that, yes, these languages are similar. So there are, say, the hey, lamed, kaf, verbal root, right? The yes. Going, walking.
Yeah, halak, root. Yes.
Okay, you have the same consonants for Aramaic, but there are some words that it's the same consonants, but it's actually a different meaning.
False friends.
Yes, the false friends kind of thing. And so I sort of collected them and tried to show that as well, just to say, hey, keep your critical thinking going at all times. Don't assume, because this looks like a Biblical Hebrew expression, that it actually is, you know?
Right.
Well, that's the same.
That's fascinating. Well, that would mean with the divine name that we only have that in Hebrew then in the biblical languages, because we don't have it brought over into Greek in the New Testament at all.
Yes.
And we don't have it in Aramaic. Wow.
Yes. Well, and it's not that it can't be expressed in Aramaic, because right. If a person is a Daily Dose of Aramaic viewer at the time that this interview is being conducted, you know that we have completed the corpus of the Bible. So every single verse of Biblical Aramaic has been covered.
Yes, congratulations on that. You're the only one that's done that so far.
Well, I had it easy compared to the others on that because of the size, right, of the corpus.
Yes.
And then afterward, as an incidental note, we did a series that was really well received by the viewership on the Aramaic words in the New Testament. So that was sort of word study-ish compared to doing a reading in the text, but it was fun, too, to do that research. But then, what happens next? And so we're reading the Targums now. And what are they? These are the Aramaic translations of the Old Testament, of the Hebrew. So God's name does appear in Targum Aramaic.
But even then, it's spelled differently, right?
There are different strategies for rendering it. So in Onkelos, depending on your manuscript, there are going to be some different strategies, such as double yod or yod vav yod or something like that.
Yeah. Okay. All right. It's great to be able to delve in and see these things. I wanted to ask you back on the viactol and the fact that we don't have that in Aramaic, but we've got the Adine and Badine. They seem to more explicitly express the idea of then, or that this is the next thing. Whereas, arguably, and I know this can get into some controversial waters, but arguably the viactol doesn't necessarily indicate that in its in its form itself. But would you have an opinion on that one way or another?
Well, I think we're getting into intentionality of the use of different forms, right? That idea, which is important to have our students as we teach them notice, you know, for interpretive purposes. So viactol appears to be serving this past narrative function in Hebrew, in biblical Hebrew, arguably being an aspect, viewpoint aspect prominent language. So here you have a tense, boing, you know, of narrative past, but it's the next item in temporal and or logical sequence. So there can be more than just a past agenda, this, then this, then this, but this, therefore this could be more of the punch, literally speaking, in a given passage with viactol. But, you know, here's this fact as well, that you can have a string of Adayan and Badayan and it stops. Okay, so you want to notice that in your reading in Daniel as well. So there's a different strategy, what appears to be a relatively similar result there.
Sure. And when you keep seeing these things, it's a marker of narrative. You're not going to see this and think poetry.
Right. There's that. Yep. There's that, yes. I mean, we don't tend to think of Aramaic poetry the way we tend to think of Hebrew poetry because, again, you know, we have whole books full of Hebrew poetry.
Sure.
But yes, the idea of what are we doing here? Well, this is narrative is important.
Right. And, you know, and when I say that, not to say that you can't have in Hebrew a viactol poetry. There are instances in the Psalms where it does that. Yeah, but comparatively few. So we can say it's generally going to show us narrative.
Right. And, you know, when we make these pronouncements, like there is no viactol, that doesn't necessarily close the case of whether in older stages of the language there was a viactol.
In the snapshot have in the Bible.
Yes.
Yes.
In the Bible, which... you know, the Aramaic in the Bible is part of a historical and geographical dialect continuum.
Well, this is neat just to be able to look at them, to see the similarities, to see the differences, see those markers like that help you break down the structure. It's just a great journey. I hope more people will get on it and delve into Daniel, Ezra, the portions in Jeremiah, Genesis, but also go beyond. You mentioned doing a Targum Onkelos and getting into the Targums. Of course, you got into the New Testament. What would you say to people about, you obviously favor doing further study beyond the biblical Aramaic, but if somebody says, well, I just really want to just focus on the Bible, what would you say to them? Well, here's why you should keep going with me in the Targums.
Well, of course, I admire Bible centrism, right? That's me. I believe that trust in the authority and sufficiency of Scripture should be at the natural center of engagement with the Bible. So I'm with the person who says that. I would just encourage them to see that we're studying languages. And so connection of the Aramaic of the Bible, continues in the religious writings in Aramaic after the Bible. So, I mean, that's one thing to think about. Now, it appears that the Targums themselves derive from an awareness of the Hebrew Bible text that's kind of been standardized already. So the value for textual criticism, again, coming back to the Bible text itself, doesn't appear to be that great. So one could look at Emmanuel Tove's textual criticism work. That's his opinion, okay? And so a person might say, well, if it's not good for textual criticism, why read the Targums? Well, in the Targums, we have a snapshot at the time of their composition of an official interpretation, or an unofficial interpretation in some cases, of the biblical text, which is interesting in the history of ideas. We need to make sure we don't go anachronistic and then use that back interpreting into the Bible, right? That this is an interpretation of Jews of the Old Testament Hebrew Bible, Hebrew and Aramaic Bible scriptures at a certain time. So it's just interesting to track and see, for instance, that there were times in the history of rabbinic Judaism when messianism was alive and well. There's a major theme, for instance. So that's good to see. Now, as for other biblically adjacent writings in Aramaic, of course, there's the Peshitta. So Syriac Christianity is a huge repository of documents, including the Peshitta. So that's an area of research that may not be for everybody's specialization, right? But this is a dialect of Aramaic as well. It uses a writing system that's sufficiently different from the Hebrew and Aramaic letters we're familiar with that it becomes a little bit harder to just immediately jump over and look at Syriac. But here you have a Bible translation that appears to have been done from the Hebrew for the Old Testament and then the Greek from the New Testament. That's an ancient version. So when you're looking in your apparatus of your Hebrew Bible, you'll see a sign for the Syriac from time to time. Well, it'd be good to kind of to be able to engage with that text critical information.
Yes.
And that's yet another benefit of studying the Aramaic for after Bible times. And, you know, we kind of spoke already about linguistic Gnosticism, right?
Yes.
And the fact that Aramaic was the language of Jesus means, unfortunately, that there's a mystification of Aramaic in the minds of some that we don't want to stoke, even inadvertently. So, you know, is it important, for instance, that we try to retrovert the words of Jesus recorded in the Greek of the New Testament into Aramaic because that was the real message? Well, that's an interesting academic exercise. Is it impossible that Jesus spoke Greek? Absolutely not. And there are Greek word plays that are quite obvious in the Sermon on the Mount.
Yes.
You see? So the original text is Greek. We should study the Greek. And in fact, as everyone knows, in the work of retroversion, we're dealing with an art, not a science.
Yes.
Because none of us are native speakers, for one thing, of the language. And you have the complex interplay of geography and history as far as what dialect it would have been and the exact form that the text would have taken. So again, it's an interesting exercise, this retroversion kind of idea.
Yes.
But saying the Lord's Prayer in Syriac and believing that we're saying the exact words of Jesus, because we're absolutely not. That's a dialect from centuries later, you know, the translation being made centuries later.
Right.
And it was made from Greek, so not with reference to whatever words may have come out of Jesus' mouth if he, in that moment, were speaking Aramaic. So think about it. It's Aramaic to Greek to centuries later to another Aramaic dialect.
That's just not how language works.
Yeah, so that's like running the automatically generated transcript of our session here, which is going to have some errors.
Yes.
So that's like taking that and then running that through a translation device to some other language and then running that through a translation device to a third language. So, you know, we don't want to encourage playing games with these languages.
No.
What we want to encourage is faithful scholarship and just all the when one engages in faithful scholarship, we're not looking for that zinger stuff. what we're looking for is just being able to understand what's there.
Yes.
And the thing is, the riches of what's there in the biblical text are so great that when you experience them, it's almost like, how in the world could you be interested?
Yes.
In deviating from that to some other plan, you know?
Absolutely. You know, too much time has been taken from scholars and people by, you know, going off into these paths of speculation of a, you know, whether it's a supposed text behind the text or another language, like you say, or some of these mystical meanings. So I really appreciate your encouragement for us to get back to the actual text we have in these languages.
Yes. Well, that's, you know, that's a passion, I believe, of the Daily Dose Ministries. So encourage people to participate in them. And of course, whenever there's a conference, come and have great fellowship with us. It was wonderful to meet biblical language enthusiasts at our Greek and Hebrew for Life conference last year.
Yes. I've benefited from...
And there's one particular one that I really enjoyed meeting at lunch.
Yeah, same here. Yeah, it was really neat to go and recognize, oh, here's the host of Daily Dose of Aramaic. Gotta sit here for a moment. So.
Yes.
Yeah, those conferences have been a big part of what fueled my continued study. And I definitely encourage folks to check those out. Well, Scott, thanks again for joining us here on the program today. And I hope those of you who are watching or listening today are seeing the value and also the practicality of studying Aramaic. This is a wonderful undertaking, and it's one that you can do, especially if you have Hebrew under your belt. And I hope you will take steps to do that.
Me too.
So let's keep studying those biblical languages, Hebrew, Greek, and don't forget Aramaic. Thanks again, Scott.
Thank you.